8th episode of Downtime Podcast, where two coworkers talk about video games. I'm Elisa.
I'm Jeremy.
And today we have a special show for you. This is going to be our first spoiler cast that we're recording. Now, if you've been following, the both of us have been playing Yakuza 0 for the past two and a half months, and we both finally finished it. Just a warning, once again, we're going to talk about spoilers for majority of the time, so this might actually be the last conversation we have about Yakuza 0. Are you ready for that?
Yeah, for Yakuza 0. Mind you, there's another Yakuza game coming out in August, like you mentioned.
Kiwami,
which is a remake of the first game, and we're going to talk in depth about that.
Yes.
We'll probably do another spoiler cast for that, so be on the lookout for that in the future.
Dude, it feels like this is the end of an era.
Pretty much. I mean, it's only been like 2 or 3 months, like you mentioned. So
yes.
Hasn't been that long since we started playing it, but yeah, we gushed over it before in previous podcasts, but this time we're really going to talk about in-depth stuff. We're going to kind of breeze over the minigame stuff since we talked about that, but if you want to touch on that,
we'll talk about that if we need to, but this is going to really talk about the storyline.
Yes.
All right, so if you don't want to listen to this, you should exit right now. All right, so the first thing we're going to do on this podcast is summarize for you what happened in this game, and then after we're gonna go in order and talk about what we want to talk about. So, Yakuza 0 is the prequel to the Yakuza series about two people, Goro Majima and Kazuma Kiryu. Mm-hmm. And so these two people are kind of, the stories are happening in parallel. Majima is in Sotenbori, Osaka, and Kiryu is in Kamurocho, Tokyo. And there's two storylines happening with this. So with Kiryu, you got, he's part of a family called the Kazama family, and that's a clan of whatever, that's a clan of the Yakuza. And what happens is he's beating up someone in this place called an empty lot. And the empty lot is just like an alleyway. And so he beats this person up. But it turns out that the person he beats up ends up dying. And there's a bunch of drama in the Yakuza. It's like, you know, how did this person die? Like, what's going on? And then it turns out that this lot has a lot of relevance. Mm-hmm. And Kiryu eventually, I guess, gets expelled from the clan, and because of this whole controversy with why did this person die on this lot? This lot's important. And then he joins forces with someone named Tachibana, and Tachibana is a real estater. And so that's the beginning of side story number one. And with that, eventually, you find out that one of the real estate lots that Tachibana wants to get is the empty lot where this murder started. And then storyline number two goes with Majima. So Majima was part of the Yakuza and then was eventually kicked out, expelled, as well as his eye was gouged out. And he had a partner before, and then that it's covered that like the partner like passes away.
Yeah.
And so what happens is he really wants to get back in the Yakuza. Like, he really, really wants it. Mm-hmm. He currently works at a cabaret club, and he gets this job from a clan member, Sagawa,
mm-hmm.
that if you kill this person named Makimura Makoto, then you can join the clan. He finds Makoto, and it turns out that she is a legally blind person, and he has no idea why everyone wants to kill her, and mm-hmm. he ends up protecting her.
A lot of things are revealed, such as we find out that Tachibana is actually the brother of Makoto, and then through a series of fortunate events, Makoto regains her eyesight, and I should mention that Makoto find barters and trades for Makoto to come to Kamurocho, and this leads Majima to go to Kamurocho as well. And so both of the main characters end up in Kamurocho. And you wait for them to meet because they never meet throughout the entire franchise.
I know.
The entire game. And when they finally meet, we'll get there later. Anyways, she's blind. Tachibana is captured by the Shibusawa's family or the Dojima family. I forget which one, but
I think technically they're both working together.
Yeah, Shibusawa is like the captain within the Dojima family.
Yeah.
But yeah, he gets captured by Shibusawa's family, and Shibusawa is one of the main three sub-villains in this game, and he's the guy that took off his glasses. That he doesn't have any more glasses. Everyone takes off their glasses by the end of the game.
Yes.
It's really funny. Shibusawa's family takes Tachibana, captures him, tortures him, and kills him. Shibusawa was very angry about that. Or was it Awano? Not Awano, it's the other guy. Daisuke, what's his name? The dude with the tattoos, the guy with the gray suit all the time.
Oh,
the,
Sakala?
No, the guy with the gray suit.
Oh, Sarah.
No, the other guy.
God.
Not Awano. Not Shibusawa.
Kuze!
Kuze. Daisaku Kuze. He's he kills the guy who killed Tachibana in a really brutal way because
Yes. You're
not supposed to kill Tachibana. Kiryu comes and saves the day, takes Tachibana, finally reunites him with Makoto, and then she realizes that her brother's dead. She tries to avenge her brother. In the process, gets shot, gets captured? Yeah? Gets captured, and then it's up to Kiryu and his best friend Ishikiyama to save Makoto from death on a boat. And Majima is also there.
Yes.
So the three of them technically go into this like boat battle and save Makoto at the end.
Yes.
Or at least it's implied.
We're gonna go really in depth with this, starting from beginning.
The very, very beginning. Yes.
Now, I guess the first thing that I want, the way this game works is you're switching between the two characters. So you start off with Kiryu.
Yes.
And I will say it took a while for me to really get into Kiryu's story. Because I guess in general I didn't feel as empathetic to him as I did Majima initially.
Yeah, me too.
And I suppose that's because you don't know Tachibana's story until maybe later in the middle of the game.
Yeah. But even more so, I still feel attached to Majima towards the end.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I still like him more as a little bit more as a character than Kiryu. I really like Kiryu. I think he's a great character.
Yeah.
But I kinda like Majima a little bit more.
Yeah. Man, I actually don't know anymore because I started really when the whole Tachibana and Kiryu friendship started coming up, I really started liking Kiryu, so.
Oh, no, yeah. Nishikiyama. I like Nishikiyama, too.
Oh, my gosh.
He's a good character.
Yeah.
Nishikiyama really brought out the human side of Kiryu for me, because
yes.
Kiryu was all stone-faced, and he didn't smile, and he didn't say anything, and I'm like, come on, man. Like, show some emotion, and Nishikiyama really brought out the emotion in Kiryu towards the end there.
Definitely.
Kiryu and both Kiryu and Majima are really low-level Yakuza thugs. Like, Kiryu's pretty much at the bottom of the food chain in his family, the Dojima family, which is headed by the patriarch Dojima. I forgot his first name, but his name is obviously Dojima. And he has three captains underneath him, Kuze, Awano, and Shibusawa. And they all take turns at trying to get Kiryu to come back to the family for questioning or just have him eliminated towards the end.
Yeah.
They all fail, except for Shibusawa at the very end, who he was pretty much the brain guy. He had the glasses.
Yes.
Classic action movie trope where the guy with the glasses is the smartest one. He's behind everything. So, as Elisa mentioned before, Majin was also at the bottom. He had his eye carved out for getting his partner killed, his sworn brother killed, during an assignment or something. And so he was forced to, he was like in solitary confinement underneath Osaka for like a really long time. And they brought, I think it was like 5 years or something, they just locked him up. Like, that's insane. It's like some next level torture crap.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, so then they brought Majima back to run a cabaret club called The Grand. And his boss, Sagawa, is controlling Majima. So what Majima had to do was make 500 million yen, and if he could do that, he could get back into the Yakuza. So man, this part really made me my blood boil when Sagawa was like, alright, you got me my 500 million yen, and then Majima was like, yeah, can I get back in the Yakuza now? And Sakaga was like, no, I need 500 million more. And it's like, you bastard! I hate you so much. Even from there, I hated Sakaga so, so much.
I know. He was annoying. I didn't like him that much.
He came at the most inopportune times.
He really did. I guess it's worth mentioning that both of them, Majima and Kiryu, they don't like killing people, or they refuse to kill people.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of this game, one of the plot points of this game is testing that idea of, you know, I don't have to kill this person, or I don't have to badly hurt this person.
Yeah.
But then, when they're going through all of these things with Tachibana and Makoto, it really starts to test the waters, and they, you know, they kind of like go off the deep end in a lot of points.
Yeah, you kind of rekindle them to Batman. Like, Batman never kills anyone, he just hurts them really badly until they're bloody.
I know. Exactly. Did you kind of, and it's a very broad question, did you expect the plot to go how it went in the first half?
I did not.
Yeah.
I didn't know what I was expecting, but that was the best part.
Yeah.
We mentioned before that this game's worth, well, at least when I bought it, it was worth $60.
Oh, yeah.
And you definitely get your money out of it. Like, some of the chapters are really short, like, lengthwise.
Oh, yeah.
Like, some of them only last 30 minutes if you just do the exact goal. But
and then some of them, with the cutscenes and all the dialogue, it lasts an hour and a half.
Yeah, and trust me, if there are cutscenes, like the beautiful cutscenes, we'll designate them as the beautiful cutscenes, which are like the traditional cutscenes, and then there's like the dialogue cutscenes.
Yeah.
Which are the cutscenes that have the character and they're like the models there and the animation's there, but their mouth is just moving and it's the actual in-game engine being used instead
mm-hmm.
of the pre-rendered engine.
Yeah.
So when the beautiful cutscenes show up, you kind of want to watch it because it's pretty much like a movie.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh wow, this is so beautiful. I wish all the cutscenes were like this. And
it's really, they're really nice.
Yeah, and I think those are the cutscenes I paid attention to the most.
You know, I was about to say, a lot of those CG scenes, there was a substantial amount of them. Like,
yeah.
If you add all the time together, it might be maybe an hour and a half, maybe. Potentially, of just those scenes.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think that, yeah, you can probably much find a movie of that online or something, you know? You
yeah,
take
exactly.
Someone probably made a movie of all the cutscenes,
mm-hmm.
and you can still get the story out of it.
Definitely. I was a little bit skeptical about whether or not Tachibana was going to be a good person or not, or whether he was actually on your side, or
yeah.
what he was up to.
Because remember there was that fight with Oda, and you're like, this guy's a bad guy.
Yeah.
And you're like, everyone in Tachibana real estate is a bad person. And then
yeah.
you find out, like, oh, they're all actually really good people.
Yeah.
Some of them, except for Oda. We'll get into that later.
Yes, we'll get into that later. And I guess that scene where he's looking over at Kamurocho when he's talking about his plan, and I just had no idea what his intentions were. In fact,
yeah.
what I actually, there's two characters that I thought who were going to be bad that ended up being on your side. So first one is Tachibana, and the second one is Kazuma, the captain.
Kazuma?
Kazuma, the captain.
Your father figure?
Yeah.
Oh,
I
yeah.
thought he was going to be bad as well.
Yeah, I had the same, I had the same feeling. I didn't know because they set him up to be this, father figure to you, and I was like,
yeah.
he can't be a bad guy, but I was like, he might be a bad guy.
Yeah, exactly.
But then it turns out he wasn't a bad guy. I was like, okay.
A lot of the three enemies of this game, they all interact with Kiryu at some point. Throughout the storyline. So she was
the three lieutenants.
The three lieutenants,
okay.
Shibasawa, Kuze, and Alano.
Yeah.
But really, Majima doesn't interact with any of them until the end of the story.
Yeah.
In the final boss battle.
Yeah, yeah, that's true, actually.
And also, I just realized, is Kiryu's storyline longer than Majima's in terms of the focal points?
Yeah, I think so, because this game was, in all the Yakuza games, most of the Yakuza games, Kiryu or one of his ancestors or someone like Kiryu is always the focus.
Oh, okay, I didn't know
yeah,
that.
Yeah, he's always been the focus, and
okay.
This was one of the first games that you could switch characters. Yakuza 5 was the first game that they had 5 different locations and 5 different main characters.
Okay.
But none of them, I think, none of them were had the ability to play as Majima.
Okay.
Because he was always viewed as, the Joker character in all the games. I don't know why, but later on, and I know Kiwami, he's, basically Mr. Shakedown. You don't get to play as any other character but Kiryu and Kiwami.
Really?
Yeah, Majima is like Mr. Shakedown. He'll find you at random points and start to fight you.
Okay.
But yeah, overall, what was
say.
Oh yeah, they all interact with Kiryu, the three lieutenants, and yeah, I think I feel like Kiryu's story is a lot longer than Majima's, mainly because he's a little bit more of the focus of the game.
Yeah. Okay. I didn't know that context in terms of the series.
Me neither.
That makes sense.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I just felt like for me, Majima's story was a little bit more relatable, just emotionally wise.
Oh, definitely. A lot of it with Majima's storyline, it just, you know, it was very touching.
Yeah, I mean, you kind of felt bad for the guy. He lost an eye.
He has to kill someone. Turns out that person's blind.
Yeah, he also lives in a shitty apartment.
I know. Where he's being watched the entire time.
Remember the part where he's looking out the window and then that cutscene and then all those people are looking at him?
Yeah.
This guy.
That was
and
creepy.
Then later on, they turn out to be like trying to fight him.
I know, that was so creepy.
I was like, hey, it's the homeless guy.
I know.
What's he doing here? Yeah, that was really creepy.
Oh, God. No lie, it was a little confusing at first with the three lieutenants because Kuze was the biggest focus throughout the story.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
That Kiryu had to fight with, that when people like Aono and Chibusawa started getting introduced, I was like, oh, there's more? And then...
Yeah.
But like, I've only been seeing Kiryu this entire time.
Yeah. And also, Kuze kept coming back.
Yeah, like, all the time.
The part in the sewer where they're fighting...
Oh, that was legit.
I thought he was gonna die. I was like, okay, fine, I get to kill Kuze.
That was
awesome. Yeah, I know.
That was so cool.
That guy lost a finger, and yet
yeah.
he kept trying to fight Kiryu. By the way, he lost a finger because he lost to Kiryu.
Yes.
And he kept trying over and over again. I'm like, is this guy gonna get more of his fingers cut off? I don't know.
I don't, by the end of this entire series.
Yeah, he's gonna have no fingers.
Which, by the way, talking about Kiryu, there is a part of the story. So, Kiryu's, one of his sword brothers and his best friend is Nishikiyama,
yeah.
Nishiki. And there is a point in the first half where, since Kiryu was kind of, I guess, expelled from the gang, and he's kind of a target of
yeah.
everyone, there
yeah.
comes a point where Nishiki does not want to be associated with him anymore.
Yeah, I remember that. And that thing in the forest, right?
Yeah, the scene in the forest, where he almost kills him.
Dramatic bromance.
Super dramatic bromance. I love the bromance, though, I gotta admit.
Yeah, it was good.
Yeah.
And I liked how... It felt more human.
It
you know?
Did.
It felt really, really human.
Yeah.
Sort of appealed me to those two characters. And that's what I think I mentioned before about Nishikiyama, how he humanized Kiryu in a way.
Yeah, definitely. Because they have this romance, and it's like brothers till the very end. And then in the first half, Nishikiyama gives up on that. Or, prioritizes his position in the clan over his friendship with Kiryu.
And then he feels like shit about it. I'm like, yeah, you deserve that.
Yeah, you do. Yeah, you do.
Yeah. Why would you put the clan over his sworn brother? Like, I know that there's like a gray line there, you know? Like,
yeah.
who do you attach to more, the clan or your sworn brother? Because the reason that your sworn brother is there is because of the clan.
Yeah.
But you wouldn't have your sworn brother if the clan didn't exist.
Exactly.
So it's like, who do you file allegiance to? And Nishikiyama was so scared, he didn't want to die.
I know.
He's like, oh, I want to sit with the clan because I don't want to die. But I love you.
Yeah, right?
It's like, what the hell, dude?
God.
And then I want Kiryu to say, are we dating? You know?
It's so frustrating.
Yeah. They're both just frustrated in general.
It's one of those.
Oh, yeah. So we covered pretty much a lot of the first half. Was there anything in the first half that you felt stood out to you the most? Like, did you have a favorite moment?
So there's two moments for me, actually. The first one was what we just talked about. It was when Nishiki was about to shoot Kiryu.
Yeah.
And the second moment, when Lee, Makoto, and Majima are trying to escape.
Yeah.
And they want to move Makoto around.
Yeah.
And when they find a car to escape to, turns out that car was bomb.
Oh, yeah.
Turns out that car had a bomb.
Yeah.
And Lee dies.
Yeah, that was probably... the moment for me that stood out to me the most with Majima's story.
Yes.
Because up until that point, no major characters on the Allies side had died.
Yes, that is very
and
true.
He was the first one. And
he was.
It just struck you the most. You're like, oh man, this guy was so cool. You know, he helped.
I know.
He helped you, but then you fought him. And
exactly.
Then he helped you again.
Yeah. That was... this whole Yakuza thing is just about people who help you, but you still fight them anyways because you're trying to prove a point to them, and then they help you, and it just goes back and forth.
Oh yeah.
But that really hurt a lot.
Yeah.
Seeing him pass away.
I'm like, oh my god, he died in the worst possible way.
I know. And then, oh my god. What really hurt was when Makoto was asking if he was okay.
Yeah, she's like, where's Lee?
He's like, I don't know how to answer that question. Oh my god. Yeah.
Well, but the guy who killed Lee was a good guy, technically.
Yes.
Well, that was the crazy part.
I know.
All these good guys killing good guys because the good guys think the other guys are bad guys, but they're actually all on the same side, but they just don't know it.
Exactly.
I'm like, man, this is real though. Like,
this is really.
It was just really.
Circle.
Yeah, it's a circle. Like it's, I say it's real, not like it could really. Well, actually, technically, it could really happen in real life if the story was like based on fact. Not but it's real in that like you get so attached to these characters despite what they did in the game that you feel as though they should live on in future games. But obviously, if you've been a Yakuza fan for a long time, then you probably already know what happens because none of these characters show up in the future.
Oh.
I'm just kidding. All of them do. No, not all of them. Some of them do, I think. Don't quote me on that. I don't know.
I know who doesn't. Lee doesn't.
I actually don't know if any of the characters that were killed at the end, I don't know if any of the alive characters at the end of Yakuza 0 show up in future games.
Okay.
I haven't played any of them. I'm just speculating.
We'll see. Well, aside from Majima and Kiryu, that's all we know.
That'd be cool if Makoto came back with her eyesight. Like, hey guys, I'm still here.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
My heart.
Lee, the Force Ghost of Lee.
Okay, so real quick.
Yeah.
Another plot. In the beginning of the Majima chapter, I guess what surprised me was the fact that Makoto was a girl and that she was blind in the first place. So and you know, just like it's a basic observation, but it's like, what the hell? This is her?
Yeah. But you know, there's significance in why
exactly
Majima had to kill her, but that's what turned Majima when he realized that this girl was just helpless and he felt sorry for her, and then he heard her story before how she was like captured and abused.
Exactly.
And all these like really bad things happened to her. And I'm sure after hearing that, he's like, oh, I feel really bad for her. I want
to
help her.
They revealed a lot to each other.
Yeah. I mean, you kind of picture not Kiryu, Majima's this really hardcore killer because he's got an eye patch and he looks really mean all the time, but then you realize he has a really good heart. And that's what you find out a lot about his sub-stories. Kiryu has a really good heart. Or not Kiryu. I keep saying it. Majima has a really, really good heart. In a lot of his sub-stories, I'm like, oh, I like you a lot, man.
Exactly.
That'd be great.
That sums up the first half of Yakuza 0, and the next part is chapters 11 through 17, which 17 is the final chapter, or the finale.
Yeah. The weird part for me with 11 was when you go to that underground fighting ring full of criminals.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, this is a cool minigame, but I was like, what the heck? Why is it under the river? It was so weird.
That was really weird.
Yeah, but I mean, it was still cool. I mean, that part really didn't grasp me as much. I was like, okay, you fight a bunch of criminals underground. Other than that, the story was kind of okay.
Yeah. I was about to say, with chapter 11, I didn't really... I guess I wasn't fully into it, where you had to meet the detective who introduced you to the underground.
Oh, that guy. Yeah. He just was there and then he died.
Yeah, he was there and that was it.
Yeah, he got shot and I was like, alright, dude.
Yeah.
I don't really care about you. I didn't really feel any remorse for him.
I didn't feel for him.
Yeah, he's just dead.
Exactly.
And then you go to... Is this the same chapter where you go to the hotel or something?
The hotel?
That big giant onsen ryokan.
Oh.
Is that where you meet Sarah? I'm trying to see. I have the guide in front of me. It's either 11 or 12.
Chapter 11 or 12.
Yeah, this is where before that. So you're still trying to find out who this guy and why it is.
Yes.
That killed Lee. Because you kind of want to get revenge. Because you're like, who is this bad guy who killed him?
Yeah. You're finding out who killed him. And this guy comes in a gray suit or gray, like, white tan suit.
Yeah.
Makoto is unconscious. He picks her up and just takes her.
So you're trying to find her. You're trying to find who this guy is and where he took her to.
And then
her.
Yeah, and that's where you meet this detective.
And he kind of points you, and, like, he gives you clues as to where this guy might be, because he's obviously Yakuza, and he's actually tied to the Dojima clan.
Yes.
I think they mentioned that in Chapter 11, where they mentioned that he's part of a bigger group that's based in Kamurocho in Tokyo.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, damn, I really need to find this guy. So then Chapter 12 begins where you go to this giant ryokan or onsen, like, spa thing, and then you fight your way. You and Sagawa go there together.
You're just fighting your way through a lot of things.
And that was a really long segment, too.
Yes.
You fight your way through a lot of things, and you finally meet the guy. His name is Masaru Sera. And you fight him, and then you beat him, and then that takes you to chapter... Because chapter 12 is mostly just fighting. And chapter 13 is where a lot of the meat comes in.
Yeah, exactly. So, when you finally meet Sera is... he's explaining to you what his position is, and... he kind of goes more in depth about the Mikio Consortium.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, okay, I feel like we should talk about this for a little bit, but can we just kind of declare the hierarchy of everything at this point? Because you got you got Dojima thrown out, you have Tojo, that name thrown out as well, and then now you have the Mikio Consortium introduced. And just kind of like, and Kazama.
And Tachibana.
And,
yeah,
and so just figuring out, or just... laying out there what all these groups are and what the levels are.
So, Dojima family's at the top.
Yes.
Headed by the Dojima patriarch. He's the leader of the entire family. Below that are the individual families of the lieutenants, the Awano family, the Shibusawa family, and the Kusei family. Below them are the... I think Nikio's consortium is either... are they part of the Dojima family, or are they working with them?
I think they're working with them.
Okay, because they're like contractors.
Yeah.
They aren't officially part of the family, but they work with them in order to attain same goals.
Yes.
Kazama family, was he a lieutenant, part of Dojima's lieutenants, I think?
I think so. He's a captain.
Yeah, he was a captain of Dojima's lieutenants, but he went to jail.
Yeah.
So Kazama is the guy who adopted Kiryu and Nishiyama into his own family, and he basically... adopted them from little sunshine orphanage and made them his sons. So they were literally looking up to him as a father figure.
Yeah.
And then Tachibana Real Estate is a group that's not really associated with the Dojima family or the Tojo clan. Who's the Tojo clan? I'm forgetting who they are.
You see, there's just so many levels of this Yakuza family.
At least he's looking it up right now. But the Tachibana Real Estate Company is led by Tachibana, and he basically was an immigrant from China who came to Japan in search of greater good, and he was always part of this criminal underground life.
Are you talking about Tachibana?
Mm-hmm.
But isn't Tachibana... he's ethnically Japanese, though, correct?
Yeah. But he grew up... Yeah,
no, he's ethnically Japanese.
But he grew up in China. And he spoke Mandarin.
Yeah. All right. Tojo clan was founded by Makoto Tojo, and it's the largest Yakuza organization. So I wonder... Oh, my God.
So I think the team is under Tojo. So Tojo is the biggest one, and they're... So Tojo is, like, the overall... great umbrella.
Yeah.
And that is everything else I just explained.
Yeah.
And Dojima is like probably one of the biggest families underneath the Tojo umbrella.
Mm-hmm. Good God.
Oh, Tojo, remember the old guy that you fought? Remember you fought that all of his minions and you paid $2 million to get your record wiped or something?
Yeah.
That was the Tojo head.
Okay.
Yeah, and then underneath him, Dojima is his subordinate.
Yes.
And Dojima is like the biggest family that controls all of Kamurocho.
Yes.
And everything else falls underneath that.
There's so many levels.
Yeah, it's...
They
it's
all blended really together. They all blended together at some point.
Yeah.
Well, the only thing that you knew distinctly was that Tachibana Real Estate was not related to the Dojima family or the Yakuza.
They were pretty much at war with the Tojo clan.
Yes.
In a stupid little piece of land.
I know. Now, going into the second half of the game is when you start getting into the importance of why this empty lot is important, and why what this whole real estate situation is all about. Because as far as you're concerned, in the first half, you're just running this real estate agency on the side, because why not?
Yeah.
And just trying to do your own thing. But then you realize that Tachibana wants to get rights, or wants to get hold of the empty lot where this murder happened. And you finally find out that the Yakuza organization has this revitalization project for Kamurocho.
Yeah.
And they want the empty lot so that they can start this revitalization project with a bunch of the bureaucrats.
Yeah.
And but you know, obviously revitalization, it's not exactly like, oh, we're gonna improve like the town and improve everything.
It's like gentrification.
Exactly. It's gentrification and obviously the mafia taking control of the area.
Yeah.
And the Yakuza are working with the government too. They're working with the bureaucrats to make this happen.
Yeah.
Tachibana Real Estate, they want control of this, one, to stop the Yakuza from getting control or getting complete control over this.
Yeah.
Especially Shibasawa.
Yeah.
But what you find out is that this empty lot, the person who owns the deed of it is Makoto.
Mm-hmm.
And that reveals why they're hunting this girl down in the first place. It's because they want to get the rights of this land, and by getting the right of this land, then you control Tokyo.
Yep. This tiny piece of land.
This tiny piece of land.
And that's why Tachibana was trying to find her, because they were brother and sister, they're related.
Yes.
Like blood brother and sister, not like the Nishikiyama Kiryu thing.
Exactly.
Not sworn brother and sister. They're actually like come from the same parents. And so
yeah.
He's doing his best to find her. And so that's why he started off in Osaka, because that's where a lot of like the criminal underworld was.
Yeah.
And then he moved up to Tokyo. I guess he heard like someone, his sister was up there or something. That's why he moved up there. And then his sister came to Japan. She heard her brother was in Osaka, so she went there. And then she eventually found herself in Tokyo because of Kiryu.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Oh. The biggest plot twist of the second half is the fact that Makoto and Tachibana are brother and sister.
Yeah, that was the biggest part.
That was, oh my man, that reveal.
They never really got to meet technically, because he died before they met.
No, stop it.
What? What?
They did meet.
Oh, well. Yeah, he's like, he was dying. He was in the process of about dying.
They
finally met. Like he was unconscious. I don't know what he said about meeting them, because he's just like in and out of consciousness.
Yeah.
But yeah, they met. Okay, yeah.
So, biggest plot twist of the game is the fact that they're brother and sister in the first place.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at the box art, they're next to each other.
That is a good point.
All these characters are relevant.
Yes.
I mean, I hope they would be relevant.
I mean,
all these characters, there's a reason why all these characters are on the box.
Yeah.
That's what that meant.
Exactly. What makes this game interesting is how they connect the Majima and Kiryu story together in the second half.
Without them meeting at all.
Because now the center point is trying to get Makoto.
She's the catalyst for them meeting and them also not meeting.
Yes.
Because they hear about each other in like sub stories and also in the main game, but they never really talk about each other.
Yeah.
They don't really meet each other.
Which, by the way, it just seems like all the Yakuza just know each other no matter what. Like,
I mean,
for example, you know, you say Majima's name and everyone just knows who he is already.
Like that Majima.
Oh, that Majima.
There could be another Majima, you know.
And I'm just like, what? Like, how do you know?
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, it's a small, I'm sure it's a small knit group, and you know, it's an exclusive club.
Yeah.
So they all have to know each other.
Oh, yeah, probably. In the second half, the hunt for Makoto gets pretty crazy. That was one of my favorite parts of the storyline, where now you have all these moving pieces, and your two main characters have different reasons to get Makoto, or no different reasons to get Makoto, and then there's these villains getting her for different reasons too, even though all these reasons are, like, come together for the same exact thing.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah.
Like, I mentioned the sewer part. Before that, Awana was, like, in a club dancing with some girl, and he shoots her, and then in front of you, you're like, why did you do that?
Exactly.
He's just crazy.
Yeah.
all the lieutenants are just crazy. Everyone in this game is pretty much crazy. Even Kiryu and Majima, they're pretty crazy.
Yeah.
But yeah, the hunt for Makoto was insane.
Exactly. And it's just, you know, the whole cyclical thing where everyone thinks that the other person's bad, who thinks the other person's bad, who thinks the other person's bad, when really there's only like three groups that are bad.
I also like how Yakuza presents that technically people aren't bad, it's just the way they think is different from each other.
Yeah.
And the way that each group perceives bad is different.
Yes.
So they think that another group is bad, but then that group thinks that this other group is bad because of the way that they're doing things.
Yes.
So technically no one is bad, they're all just different minded.
Yes.
I thought that was really cool.
That was very cool.
It's like, yeah, that's why Lee died.
That is why Lee died. Very unfortunate, but
yeah.
And this is the chapter as well where both of them, they cross to the different neighborhoods. So Kiryu goes to Sotenbori for the job to pick up Makoto. And after Majima finds out that Kiryu picked up Makoto, he goes to Kamurocho to find her.
Yeah. It was kind of cool playing as the different characters in the different cities.
Exactly.
It was weird playing as Kiryu in Osaka and Sotenbori, because I was trying to do all the... I was trying to run the cabaret club. I was like, I can't go to Club Sunshine.
I know.
I was like, God damn it. I don't want you to go to Club Sunshine. That'd be so cool.
I know.
Yeah.
Oh, and Tachibana has a worker named Oda.
Mm, yeah.
And Oda is, for the most part, good. And throughout chapter one, Oda and Kiryu start working together, and they start... doing all these things.
First,
and
you fight him.
Exactly.
First, you think he's a bad guy.
Yeah. Well, you fight everyone because that's what being a Yakuza is all about.
You fight them and then they forgive you and you become friends and they become important.
Exactly.
That is how all the Yakuza games work. Trust me, I think that's how they're all going to work.
Basically.
Yeah.
But when after Oda and Kiryu pick up Makoto and bring her back to Kamurocho, there is a very interesting turn of events where Oda and Makoto actually knew each other before.
Yeah, that's right. Before that, you were on this really weird highway chase scene.
Exactly.
And you were like, it was probably one of the most out-of-the-way parts of the game, like at least modes of the game that I found interesting because it was a shooter.
It was the most unique battle.
Yeah, and you were shooting missiles from helicopters, you were shooting guys off of bikes. It felt like something from Grand Theft Auto almost.
You know, if you think about it, Kiryu was killing people in that highway chase.
Oh yeah, he was shooting people left and right.
Yeah.
I liked how it was really different.
Yes, it was very different.
And yeah, you can't say that he wasn't killing people. I mean, these cars light on fire and explode.
Exactly.
And these guys that fall off their motorcycles end up exploding.
Yeah.
It's so ridiculous.
I know.
But it was very, I guess, very over the top, which a lot of what Yakuza is it's serious at times, but it's also over the top during those serious moments. You're like, how do they pull this off? But they do it really well.
I think what's nice about this is since majority of the battling is through fight mode, and you're battling groups of people or you're battling an individual, having this shooting part was different.
Yeah.
And it shook things up.
It was a nice change of pace.
Yes.
But yeah, so after the shooting part, you arrive at like a construction building, or building under construction, I should say, and you, Oda confronts you, and then he reveals to you that he can't go back to Kamurocho, or he can't go to Kamurocho, and that he was basically the guy with the bat tattoo. And earlier in the game, Makoto mentions that there was a man with a bat tattoo that abused her and like raped her and did all these really horrible, horrible things to her. And you realize and you find out that Oda is the guy with the bat tattoo, and you're like, this guy isn't a good guy after all. Like, he was good to you, but I'd say he was 85% good in the game. The other 15% of him was pretty bad.
The gray line.
Yeah, like he was not a very good guy, but he did help you, so I consider him in the good section, but the things he did to the characters that were important to you.
Oh, they're terrible.
Yeah.
They're so bad.
He was a piece of shit human being.
Yeah.
You know? And I was like, oh, God, why Oda? You seem like such a cool guy with your,
I know, he
with your weird hair.
It was all a lie.
Yeah, with your Hawaiian shirt and your long, weird hair.
I think that was the reveal that was very disappointing to me. Obviously, people turn out bad and people turn out good, but
yeah.
Finding out that Oda was the one who hurt Makoto, especially because I really like her character.
Yeah, and I was beginning to like Oda, too.
Yeah.
And I really like Makoto, too. I thought Makoto's character was really well-developed, you know?
It was.
And... as we talked about before, there are a lot of twists and turns in the game.
Yeah.
And none of them feel cheap. You don't feel cheated when you see them or when they happen.
I don't. Everything, all the twists made sense. Nothing really jumped the shark.
Mm-hmm.
And it felt very natural.
It felt wholesome.
Yes.
You know? By the end of the game, you feel like, this is a complete game. I am happy with this. Like,
yes.
If this is the only game in the franchise, I'd still be happy with
it.
Oh,
yeah. Same here. I'm very happy with it.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Definitely.
And, well, you know, I'll talk about it later. I'll talk about my thoughts and feelings at the end.
Yeah.
So
we're going through this, and obviously people are chasing everyone's chasing Makoto, so
yeah.
Oda has to die.
Yeah.
And then the next target is Tachibana.
Shibasawa is actually the one who kills Oda, like,
yes.
Point blank in the face.
I know.
God. I was like, that's freaking brutal, dude.
I know, right?
Oh, man.
And then next on the kill list is Tachibana, except before So Tachibana's not immediately killed. Tachibana kind of gives himself up to be tortured because Tachibana kind of knows that they're not going to immediately kill him because they want information from him.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And you know, Tachibana would rather do that than have Makoto die. So
yeah.
Also, this scene introduces this really creepy-ass fucking character, Lao Guy.
Yeah, he's an assassin from mainland China, and his face looks like the moon.
I know. It has, like, blackheads, and there's
he's
just,
scarred.
Like, he's scarred, and pores are huge, and he just doesn't look good. And his skin's great. Like, come on.
Like, come on, wear a mask or something.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, not like a Jason mask, but like put him like a facial mask on. Like,
oh,
you know,
he's
go
so
to a spa.
Creepy.
Yeah.
He's so creepy.
He looks like he hasn't slept in days.
I know.
And he shoots Kiryu in like the stomach, lower abdomen area.
Yeah.
And so Kiryu's out for the count. Tachibana gives himself in.
Exactly.
And gets tortured.
Exactly. And Lao Dai is hired by the Dojin family, by the way.
Yeah.
Oh my god. There you go. That's what we're missing. This whole entire situation's going down. Kiryu is kind of by himself protecting Makoto. And then Nishiki comes out of the woodwork. And...
Finally.
Yeah. Nishiki comes back. And you think that they're about to kill Kiryu. But it turns out that Nishiki comes back to join Kiryu again. And join the good side because... Girls will be bros.
Yeah, Nishiki gave him. Basically, Nishiki's risking his place in the Dojima family to help
for
Kiryu.
Friendship.
Yeah, and I was like, that's the right thing to do, you know?
That's true. It's true love. If you think about
it is true love, yeah.
Yeah!
He wasn't being selfish anymore.
I know. And, God, just their bromance gets to me.
A lot of sexual tension between the two of them. Just
oh
kidding.
Oh my God.
I'm joking.
I only think this is funny because down somewhere, someone is writing fan fiction about Nishiki and Kiryu.
Or we just go to rule34.com.
Oh my god, no, we're not.
that's a deep road that we're not
going to No, we're not going to do that.
No, never, never, ever.
Not on this podcast, at least.
Oh, not ever.
He's back and everything, I was really happy. I felt like all was good in the world when Nishiki comes back to you. I felt so excited. By the way, I played from chapter 12 straight to the end. So just all of this is going down, and then just like I was excited.
Damn, really?
Oh god.
You just marathoned it.
It was.
But it's such a good game.
It's,
like, it's hard to put down.
Good game. At that point too, I felt I was adequately leveled up.
Yeah.
So if by continuing on, I didn't feel like I needed to do any extra. Farming,
yeah,
extra money farming.
Oh, yeah. And towards the end, you just feel as though
You just feel like a badass at the end.
I
feel
do.
You're just killing tons of dudes.
I feel like a
you're with your
badass.
Bro.
I know.
And you're just like, let's just be
exactly.
A dudes.
Exactly.
It's great.
So we're here. Tachibana is getting tortured. You have to fight Kuze again because this motherfucker doesn't disappear ever. But then what ends up happening is Tachibana dies.
Mm-hmm.
Which is very unfortunate. And what happens is Tachibana is dying, and there's a hope that he might be able to see Makoto. So Nishiki is trying to find Makoto in her hideout.
Yeah.
But she doesn't make it on time
mm-hmm.
for him to be alive.
It's so sad. She's like, where is he? Where is he? She's like, what is this? She's like, no, it's not my brother. And I was like, ah.
And then my tears.
Yeah.
They fall from my face.
Yeah.
That was a really sad part. There are actually a lot. Like, this is the last half of the chapter where shit just gets
mm-hmm.
really depressing.
Also, Makoto's, like, on a rampage now.
I know.
He's become this revenge rampage.
Exactly.
And I'm like, oh my god, this blind girl can almost see, and now she's gonna kill everyone.
Yeah, so, the biggest thing coming out of Tachibana's death is that Makoto's able to see again.
Yes.
To an extent.
Yeah.
And she ends up running away from Kiryu and Nishiki. They can't find her at all.
Yeah, that's right.
And they're looking for her. Now, obviously, Majima's motivation for protecting Makoto is just because he develops a friendship with her and develops this relationship, and he
yeah.
wants to protect her, and he knows that she's a good person, doesn't deserve any of this.
Yeah.
Now, Kiryu and Nishiki's motivation for protecting Makoto is out of respect for Tachibana, because
yeah.
they really liked him, and everything that Tachibana did for Kiryu, Kiryu wants to do and protect his sister.
Yeah, and I thought that was very noble.
It was very noble. Now, we freaking go into Majima coming to Kamurocho to find Makoto, and freaking Makoto's on this goddamn roof.
Yeah.
And you're like, Makoto, how the hell did you get
up
here?
How did you get up there? What are you planning to do?
Please
don't jump.
Yeah, like, what the hell is going on right now? So Majima finds Makoto.
Yeah.
But it's this weird situation where Makoto is gaining back her eyesight, but she still can't fully see Majima when he comes into the picture.
Yeah.
And still doesn't know what he looks like. Aside from their conversation that he lost in
eyes. He's just like a silhouette to her.
It was really cute because in the first half of the game, there's two things. So one, Makoto has a broken watch. And
yeah.
the watch just doesn't work. And this is when Makoto still and Majima are still getting to know each other. So there's a broken watch that doesn't work, and so she takes off the watch.
Yep.
And two, when Makoto is scared of Majima, Majima tries to comfort her by buying her takoyaki in the first half of the game.
Yeah.
One of the best foods ever.
Oh, yeah.
And in the second half, Majima wants to comfort Makoto again by buying her takoyaki in Tokyo.
Yeah.
And he goes to buy takoyaki, and Makoto runs away again and is missing, finding
yep.
Patriarch Dojima, and that's where she bargains.
Yeah, she somehow makes her way to the three lieutenants, and I was like, how did you find them?
So she can see, like, she sees everything except for Majima's face, which, by the way, this is relevant towards the end of the story.
Yeah.
Yes. So she can see all these goddamn things, but she can't see this guy with an eye patch.
Do you want to explain that real quick, though?
Yeah.
Yeah. Go ahead. If you want to go ahead and explain that.
Yeah. You want me to explain it?
Yeah.
Explain the ending.
Explain why she can't see his face.
Oh.
Yeah.
Isn't it just because she's going in and out of eyesight? It's not completely healed yet?
Oh, yeah. Well, it's just funny that it was specifically Majima.
Oh, yeah. Specifically, Makoto can see all this shit except for
yeah.
Majima's face. Like, come
yeah.
on.
It's like, I get it.
Yeah.
He's got an eye patch.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Like, I don't get it. Anyways.
Yeah.
So, freaking Makoto makes this bargain. Dojima doesn't want to bargain with her. Majima is climbing up this building to find her, and this Lao guy shoots her.
Yep.
And
in the abdomen, I think.
In the abdomen.
Yeah.
Yes. And she's dying. Majima finds her. Majima beats up a bunch of people. Majima kind of, like, he goes crazy. He goes ham trying to find this girl.
He does.
And freaking, he does. Takes her to the hospital, and when he finds Makoto, Sarah from Mikio Consortium is also following behind, and kind of they hide her in a hospital, or they go to a special hospital that Sarah works with just to make sure that Makoto's healing. This game has a weird thing of you're trying to hurt them and it looks like they die, but they purposefully choose a spot to puncture or shoot them that they know they're not going to die from.
Yeah, like, they planned that beforehand.
Exactly. It's like, for example, so Sabuha gets shot at some point. Turns out they shot his hand. I'm like, what the hell? Like, it's an ongoing trend with this goddamn game.
So Sagawa got shot when Lee died.
Yes.
So when Sagawa got shot, I'm like, yes!
Yes.
And then he came back, I'm like, no. Like,
yeah, that's
weird.
So that's another trend with this game. So we're finally reaching the end. We're trying to heal Makoto. At this point, both Majima and Kiryu both know that Makoto is kind of like in a very critical condition, like almost like coma inducing. So this is the point where you kind of find out that also Sagawa is on your side too. That he's not like trying to kill her.
Yeah.
Initially.
Yeah.
And on top of that, you find out that Kazuma is also on your side.
Yeah.
And the reason, and so this force of Sagawa, Kazuma, and Sarah, the reason why they want to protect Makoto is because Patriarch Dojima wants control of the empty lot for the revitalization project for, you know, sketch reasons.
Mm-hmm.
But Kazuma and Sarah want to regain that lot so the revitalization project does not happen under Dojima's name, and so that they can end up being the, I guess, leader of the family.
Using it for whatever purposes they want.
Exactly.
I thought that was a more noble case.
Yeah.
Dojima's pretty corrupt.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, they're all Yakuza, they're all pretty corrupt.
Yeah, they're all pretty corrupt.
But Kazuma is, like, the least corrupt.
Exactly.
and Sarah's pretty nice, too.
Yeah.
Nice guy.
Yeah.
Nice guy, Sarah.
Yeah. So, I will have to, so we're finally closing in, you finish all of your stuff to the point of no return, and I just have to say, this is like one of the most epic boss battle sequences, or just chapters I've ever
this
played.
This is long,
in.
Too.
It was long. It was 2 hours, I think.
Yeah.
It was an hour of going through the boss battles, and it was an hour of watching a movie.
Yep.
And finishing.
Yep.
Finishing the game.
Once that's all over, you feel relaxed.
Exactly. But this was how this all went down was pretty awesome, in my opinion. So, Kiryu is trying to find this boat where Makoto's in hiding, essentially.
Yeah. Yeah.
And Majima finds the Dojima family headquarters and just tears it all up, pretty much.
Yep.
And
great.
Yeah, and just the entire sequence was really awesome.
Yeah, it definitely felt like an action movie.
It did.
I thought that was like that's what appealed to me the most.
Oh,
like,
yeah, totally.
This is an action movie.
Yeah, and you have Kiryu fighting. So he fought Kuze, he fought Awano, and then Shibasawa is the final boss battle for him.
Yep.
And then for Majima, it's Lao guy, who's the final boss battle for him.
Yep.
And it was just super epic in all kinds of ways.
Mm-hmm.
And, oh, also, wait, actually, does Majima fight Awano? Who does Majima fight when they take off their shirts?
I don't remember either.
It was super epic though.
It was really badass.
Because kind of like as this last battle, last stand, they both take off their shirts to reveal their tattoos.
Yeah, yeah.
Kind of like hell yeah, my Yakuza, you know.
Yeah, kind of going off of that, in Yakuza culture, having a lot of tattoos is part of being Yakuza.
Yeah.
And just showing that you are part of this group that is both illegal and also honorable.
Yeah.
Well, they don't think it is illegal, but obviously if you go to Japan, you can't go into any onsen or spa with having tattoos.
Yeah.
So the fact that they take off their shirts and show those tattoos,
yes,
means that, like you just said, that they are Yakuza and they're ready to fight anything that comes in their way.
Yeah, definitely. It was really awesome.
Yeah, it was like one of those moments I'm like, hype. Like, yes. Let's go.
And I guess one of the biggest plot points of this is that there are people. So a reoccurring theme of this is Kiryu and Majima don't really want to kill people, but they're both at their wit's end trying to find Makoto. That Kiryu is about to kill Shibasawa, Majima actually kills Lao Gai in the final chapters.
Yeah,
and just talking about the ending with Kiryu and how Nishiki stops him, and the whole thing kind of turns into a bromance of like, you know, if you cross this path, if you want to kill someone, then I want to be there with, or like I want to be like next to you doing it too.
Yeah.
But like now is like not the right time.
Yeah.
Where Majima, he just like does not give a fuck because this guy shot Makoto and he just fucking kills him.
I think it was crazy.
I know.
Yeah, no, I thought it was a very, very successful ending.
Yes.
I mean, you feel as though you completed a whole story, like I said before. And
Makoto survives in the end.
Yeah, so
she's alive.
I think she'll show up in later games. I don't know.
That would be nice.
That'd be cool to see her again.
Yes.
Like an older version. Because they're all like younger.
Exactly. Now, going into finally, the last hour of the game is an epilogue. And you're just watching it.
Mm-hmm.
So, and it's everyone's lives 1 month later. Dojima is in jail. Sarah has control now over the clan.
Mm-hmm.
The revitalization project did not happen. Kiryu and Nishiki are, you know, doing their thing. And the biggest thing of the ending is what happens with Majima and Makoto. And, Majima, Makoto, and Sagawa.
Mm-hmm.
So Sagawa and Majima kind of have this, all right, you know, this is the end of our chapter, of our relationship together, so, you know, good luck.
Mm-hmm.
And then Majima leaves, and Sagawa, it's weird because, you know, he's happy, and then he ends up being found by a kind of a bunch of hitmen, and Sagawa gets shot.
Yep.
And on top of, and just kind of like, it's weird because it's like Sagawa knew he was going to die also.
Yeah.
And then Majima, he buys a new jacket, he gets a haircut.
Yep.
And he is going about his business, and he sees a girl getting harassed, and that girl getting harassed is Makoto.
Mm-hmm.
And Majima walks up to her and is, you know, like trying to talk and to get these bullies away from her and stops the bullies. But then Makoto is scared because she doesn't know who this guy is.
Yep.
Which, coming back to what I was saying earlier, when Makoto was in and out of eyesight, Majima was the only person she was never able to see in what he really looked like. So at this instance, she did not know at all what he looked like.
So it's like this guy who has had so much history with her, who saved her and everything.
Yes.
And yet she still doesn't know who he is.
Exactly.
That's kind of sad to me.
It was really sad.
Yeah.
And I think what made it really sad too was that Majima decides that he doesn't want her ever finding out.
Yeah.
And that was depressing. What ends up happening in the end is after Majima saves Makoto from the harassers. There's a Makoto's doctor who helps with her eyesight, walks up to her, walks up to them and asks if there's a situation. Majima pulls the doctor to the side, and because he doesn't want to talk to Makoto, and says, you know, I want you to love Makoto and make her happy. And I'm just like, God damn it!
Like, I had enough of this.
You're like, what are you doing?
Yeah, like, why is this still a thing?
I know. And at that point, Majima chooses to not reveal his identity to her.
Yeah.
What did you think about that ending?
I liked it. I thought it was bittersweet.
Yeah, it was very bittersweet.
And I think it definitely sets up for the future, because they obviously, they had to retcon a lot of things with this game, but they couldn't build off of anything that they already made, you know?
Yeah.
Like, the golden rule is, like, you know, don't do anything that the characters already did in the future, or don't make it so that there are any paradoxes in the future for future games.
Yeah.
And it makes sense, you know? Like, you want to keep the timeline consistent.
Yeah.
So I thought they did a good job of doing that.
Yeah, it was really bittersweet. I liked it, but it was very sad, too. It's like, they're not even friends, you know? Or, like, and now they just have the memories.
Yep.
And then, to make it even more sad, in the first half, Makoto had a watch that wasn't working.
Yeah.
And Makoto takes off that watch when she's with Majima. Makoto visits the place where, Makoto visits the empty lot where Tachibana dies.
Uh-huh.
And when she's putting flowers on the ground, she hears this ticking. And she kind of hears, like, this sound coming out. And she looks at the ground and she finds the watch that she took off with Majima.
Yeah.
It's fixed.
Yeah.
As kind of like Majima's last experience with her, I suppose.
It's like his final goodbye to her.
Thanks for everything.
And
I know.
Thanks. Like, aww.
I know. So that was really sad. I was totally crying at that point. I was like, why does it have to be this way?
Well, that shows you it was a good story.
I know.
Yeah.
It's so sad.
Seriously.
God damn. You know, I think, so obviously this is now fan prediction, but I think at that point, when I think that when she finds the watch, I think she realizes that the guy who saved her was Majima.
Yeah.
Or has an idea of, like, this guy, Majima, is still in the area.
Yeah.
Kind of protecting her, if that makes sense.
Yep. No, I agree.
Yeah.
It's like a sign for her to see that there's someone watching out for her.
Yeah, exactly.
She doesn't have anything anymore, you know?
Exactly.
So I was like, oh, that's kind of nice.
Yeah, it is really nice. It was really sad. But that brings us to the ending of this game.
Yeah.
And credits.
Mm-hmm. And overall, I was very satisfied with this game.
Oh, definitely.
I definitely got my money's worth. I got my time's worth.
I got my dollar's worth
for
this game. This is honestly, this might be one of my favorite games. I'd have to dwell on it a little bit more, but I really like this game a lot.
No, yeah, me too.
I definitely suggest playing it for everyone.
Mm-hmm. If you haven't, and people always say, if you haven't played a Yakuza game before, play this one. 100% agree with that. Play this game. You won't feel like you're cheated in any way. It's a really, really good single player experience.
Definitely. Like, there's so much to do, and it gives a lot of background on the two characters that are featured in the game.
Yeah.
In the series.
Who knows? You might even pick up some Japanese.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah.
I think what's nice about games like this is, humanizing, it's this interesting line of humanizing people who are bad.
Yeah.
Because let's face it, Majima and Kiryu are bad.
They're pretty bad guys. They join the Yakuza. They
exactly.
You can't get any worse than that.
Yeah. They're pretty bad people, but they have a human side, which is why I like games that bring up that gray area of, you know, a person is both good and bad.
Yeah. No, I agree. I totally agree.
Yes. Damn, so I guess that brings us to the end of our discussion about Yakuza 0.
Yeah, it's been fun talking about Yakuza all
the time. It's been fun. We both finished the game at the same time, too.
Yeah, yeah.
Just in time for this podcast. And I give it 2 thumbs up, and definitely yes to playing it.
Yeah, if I had three thumbs, I'd give it three thumbs up. But I don't, so I'll give it two thumbs up as well.
You can give Kuze's thumb.
I like that joke.
Oh my god. Alright, so let us know what you thought about this game.
Yeah, tell us in the comments below. We will read them.
Yes. And thank you for listening to the 8th episode of Downtime Podcast. Our last time we'll be talking about Yakuza 0 and our very first spoiler cast.
Yep. It's
been fun. Yes, it's been fun. And we will talk to you next week.
Bye-bye.